Hello everybody, thank you to be there and to attend this presentation. So I will speak about 16 new features, which is logical decoding from standby. So first, a few words about me. So I am around databases since about 25 years. I used to do a lot of Oracle, but this is over because I fell in love for Postgres. And that's why now I am working at AWS in the RDS Postgres contributor teams, when we mainly contribute to Postgres upstream, bug fix, new features, this kind of stuff. You can follow me on Twitter on this handle, and this is my blog. As you can hear, I am French, but I think my accent is not a problem today for you there, so I think that's fine. So, about the agenda. So first, we will see what logical decoding is about. After that, what logical decoding on standby is about. The history of this effort, because it took some time to implement this new feature. So I will try to explain why and the main challenges that have been faced during the implementation, and also how we address them. And also we will see this new feature in action, hopefully with a live demo. And then logical decoding on standby is the foundation to slot replication between primary and standby, which hopefully will be there in 17. It has been committed recently, but in case there is a bug, this will be reverted. And I will show here how we can do that manually currently in 16 with a cron job or stuff like this. So first of all, what is logical decoding? So how many of you are aware of the difference between logical replication and streaming replication? Nice. So basically, very simplified, we can say that streaming replication is something like, please replace this bit in this block by this bit, and logical replication is, please replace this row by this row, simply. So with that in mind, it's easy to understand that for streaming replication, we replicate all or nothing. I mean, you have to replicate the same server. But for logical replication, you can do some filtering. You can filter on the database, then also on the table, and even on the table on the rows, and even on the rows on the column. So that it's easy also to understand that the streaming replication is much more consuming network bandwidth because it's everything. Also, other differences. In streaming replication, the standby is in a recovery mode, means there is a lot of stuff that we cannot do. I mean, almost everything except select if you are in hot standby mode, and even not select if you are in warm standby mode. While with logical replication, you can do everything because this is a normal Postgres instance, not in recovery. So there is some benefits of doing logical replication. Other benefits is for streaming replication, you have to replicate from the exact same version. So for example, from 16 to 16 here. You cannot do that from 16 to 17, to 15. And with logical replication, you can mix the versions. For example, you can replicate from 16 to 16, 16 to 15, 14, and so on. So now we will see what logical decoding on standby is about. So currently, a typical case is you have your primary, you have a standby, and maybe you have a logical replica as well. You have an application using the logical replica, an application using the primary, and an application using the standby. So as you can see, the primary is doing a lot of stuff. It's servicing the application, but it's also doing streaming to the standby and logical decoding, because this is the primary that is doing the logical decoding to the logical replica. So the idea behind logical decoding on standby is simply to move this workload from the primary to the standby so that the primary has less stuff to do. Now a few words about the history of this effort. Yeah, so the initial proposal was done in 2016. So Hopefully, all the features does not take too long, that long. The next major effort has been done in 18. And there is back and forth during years. I personally jumped in this thread in 2021. I think the reason why it took so long is because it was very challenging to design, and I will try to explain why. So let's see the main challenges that have been faced. So we need to detect and handle conflicts, so I will explain what I mean by that. And also in the live demo, we will see conflicts. And how to handle promotion when you promote the standby. You don't want to break the decoding. You want it to resume perfectly and not to break. Also the logical world center. So those are the ones that are doing the logical decoding were awakened too early on the standby. And we will see how we address that. And yeah. And maybe other stuff that I am not aware of because I jumped in this thread in 2021. So how to detect row removal conflicts. So what I mean by that? I mean that you can replay a wall record from the primary to the standby that will delete stuff, data on the standby that will be needed by logical decoding. Let me give you an example. So here, this is the standby. I create a logical replication slot. So here, host standby feedback is set to off. So there is no, the standby is not telling the primary what it is doing in terms of transaction. And then on the primary now, I create a table. So it means I insert a tuple in PG class, among other stuff. Then I drop the table, mean I delete this tuple from PG class, among other stuff. And a vacuum PG class now. Means there is no record anymore of this new relation in the catalog. It completely disappeared. And now, if I want to use this logical replication slot, it's not possible because there is missing information and the logical decoding need to access the catalog contents. So we have to emit a conflict. So let's see how we did that. So first of all, it affects only catalog or user catalog table. So user catalog table is, you know, when you create a table, you can say with user catalog table equal to. So they're affected as well as catalog. So we need to have the snapshot conflict origin. So I will explain quickly what it is for each change, but it is already in the code. Nothing has changed in this area. So we just need to rely on it. No code change in 16 for that. So in the previous example, when I was there, when I dropped the table, we can say again very simply that the snapshot conflict origin for this is the transaction where I dropped the table. So just keep this in mind. So we have the snapshot conflict origin now. But again, it affects only catalog or user catalog table, so we need to know if the wall record that will produce the conflict on the standby is linked to a catalog, yes or no. If I am going too fast, please don't hesitate to ask questions. Yeah, so we can say it's very easy, the startup process doing the recovery. When it reads the wall record, it simply can query the catalog and say, is this wall record linked to a catalog, yes or no? But the problem is that the startup process does not have access to the catalog at all. So we need to find something else. So what we did is every wall record, so the wall that already contained the snapshot of conflict origin, there is 9 of them, I think. We need to add a flag saying yes or no, we are on a catalog table. So let's go back to the previous example. So I drop the table, I have the snapshot conflict origin, then I run my vacuum. The vacuum collect the snapshot conflict origin. Again, it's oversimplified, but you got the idea. And then the vacuum knows that it is running on PG class, it knows that it is a catalog table, and so it has the extra flag catalog to yes. So typically, this wall record could generate a conflict on the standby. So adding this new flag is very easy for the tables because it's already part of the, let's say, C struct in the C code for the tables, but this is not the case for the indexes. For this one, we tested three different approaches. So the first one is, so when you manipulate an index in the C code, you know to which table it is linked. So you could open the table that is associated to the index and then check if the table is a relation or not, and then deduct that the index is also a catalog. So this is the first one that you tried. The second one is to add a dependency between PG index and the relation, so that if this is a catalog, this is also a catalog for the index. And the last one that we tried is, so in every C function that will generate this wall record, a link to an index, we will add an extra argument, which is the table associated to it, so that we can check when we emit the wall record if it is a catalog, yes or no. So we choose the last one because for the first one, we realized that it could generate, in some cases, some deadlock. And the second one was more difficult to maintain. So we choose the last one, which is pure mechanical C code change in the function arguments. But now I have a question for you. Is all this stuff even needed if hot standby feedback is set to on? Because at the beginning, I said, when I gave the example of the conflict, I said hot standby feedback was set to off. So who of you think that it is needed if hot standby feedback is set to on? No, it's not needed, yeah. So as usually, there is a trap because the right answer is it depends. So it depends of what? It depends if there is a physical replication slot between the primary and the standby, so that you can manipulate with the primary slot name on the standby. So let me explain why. So here we are our primary. So our standby feedback is set to off here, okay? So what we are interested in is the catalog xmin from the standby. So with hot standby feedback set to off, obviously it is not known. Now if I set hot standby feedback to on, it's known. But now suppose the standby crash or is shut down, then hot standby feedback is dead as well. So it's again not known. Unless you created a physical replication slot through a primary slot on the primary, and then it previously recorded the value that hot standby gave him. So it's known because it's recorded in the primary. So you need to have a physical replication slot and hot standby feedback to on to ensure that you will not get any conflict. So we could mandate that. I mean, why taking care of all the conflicts if we can just ensure this parameter? But we did not want to mandate that configuration because when the primary is down, there is no way we can ensure that it has a physical replication slot or no. I mean, it's down, so we don't know, simply. And as well, because if the standby is inactive, then you could start to accumulate, you know, wall records on the primary, like we currently have the case in 15 with the physical replications for that. So that was it for the conflicts due to row removal. That was the main, let's say, difficult part that we have to take care about. Another type of conflict is the wall level conflict. We want the primary to have wall level to logical, to emit what is needed in the wall record. So we need to generate a conflict when it is not the case. For this one, it was not that easy because we already have a wall record that knows about parameter change. So we just need to take care of that. Then how to deal with conflict? Should we remove the slot on the standby or invalidate the slot? So initially we remove the slot, then we change our mind to invalidate the slot because this is currently the case for the physical slot, you know, when max wall keep size is reached on a, on a primary. So it's invalidated, so we are doing the same here. Then how to handle promotion? So you don't want the decoding to break when there is a promotion. Yeah. You have to use the right timeline. It's not difficult per se, but there is a lot of there is some code change during the development cycle of this feature in this area, in the timeline area. So that's why you have to come back and forth. Yeah, so last one, I think, is the logical wall sender were awakened too early. So the logical wall sender are the processes that are doing the logical decoding. So before the new feature, it was on the primary only. So on the primary, they were awakened when the wall record was flushed. So it was perfectly fine on a primary. But you cannot do that on a standby, because you have to wait for the wall record. You know it's coming from the primary to the standby. It has to be replayed, so the recovery has to be done. And once it is done, only the logical decoding can read it. So to achieve that, we need to find a new way to wake them up on the logical, on the standby. So we build a new machinery in place, depending of the wall sender type. So let me explain. So here you have a standby with the process of interest for this discussion. And let's say you have a cascading standby. Here this step is a wall record coming from the primary. So it reaches the wall receiver flush it. And then we will wake up the physical wall sender and the startup process. The physical wall sender will send the wall record to the cascading standby, if any. And the startup process will do the recovery. And once the recovery is done, it can wake up the logical wall sender. So that's how we did it. Yeah, and we had some stuff to do as well. We had a wall record alignment issue in the code. We had to create a special function as well, because when you create a logical replication slot, it is waiting for a special kind of wall record to get a consistent point of view of the transaction that are running. So you can have this wall record when you launch a checkpoint, but it could be too heavy to launch that. So we create a special function that I will use in the demo just to emit this wall record. And there is a lot of tests. I mean, the tests in the Postgres are done with a Perl script, mainly for the tab test. And the one linked to this new feature is the second largest tab test in terms of number of lines. Not sure it's a good criteria, but at least it means something. And maybe other stuff that I am not aware of. So finally, this new feature is made of, so in 16, is made of 8 commits in the Postgres source tree. Those one. And now it's time for a demo, but I can maybe answer a question if you have before. Everybody can see, even in the back. Yeah? Okay, cool. So Let's start the demo. Oops. Okay, so here I am setting up a 15 environment, so before the feature. Here I am setting up a 16 environment, so with the feature. Here I am starting a primary in 15. Okay, and then so on the left the primary, on the right the standby in 15 as well. So, in 15, when I am on the standby, so I am in recovery, to the standby, if I want to create a logical replication slot, it's not possible. So, yeah, I mean, that's why we build the feature. So, let's shut down this stuff and do the same in 16. So, I start the 16 primary on the left. And on the right, I start the 16 standby. So I am in recovery because I am a standby. And then I will create a logical replication slot on the standby, which is hanging for the one, this wall record that I talked previously, is waiting for a consistent snapshot of the transaction from the primary to arrive. And this function emits that. So now I create a table on the primary. I insert some data on it. And I am able to see the change from the standby. So the create table, the insert, has been replayed on the standby. And then once replayed, I am able to logical decode from it. Let's use another program to do the logical decoding. So I insert some data in it. So as you can see, it has been decoded on the right, on the standby. And then let's open a new window, connect to the standby. So it's in recovery, I am on the standby. And let's promote it. So it has been promoted. As you can see, the logical decoding is still waiting. I mean, it has not been canceled or broken or whatever. It's there. Means now if I insert some data on the standby that has been promoted, yeah, the logical decoding is still happening. So here we have seen that we can logically decode from the standby. If I promote the standby, nothing is broken, and I can continue resume logical decode from it. Yeah, so let me clean this stuff now. So that was the first example. So I am rebuilding the 16 from scratch. So this is the new primary. And here, this is the new standby. So I start, I connect to the primary, I create a table, I create a publication. And I link both, the table and the publication. And on the standby, I am in recovery, I am on the standby. As you can see, the publication is there. I mean, it will have been the same on 15, it's replicated, but on 15 it's not usable. And the table is there, but and empty. So now I open a new window, and in this new window, I will create a subscriber node. So again, I start another Postgres instances, which will be the subscriber. And now, so I create the table as well. And I will create the subscription, but I will not subscribe from the primary, but from the standby. When you create a subscription, it will create a logical decoding slot, a logical replication slot on the provider side, which will be the standby here. So let's take the port of the standby. Oops. Copy it and put it in there. So I create a subscription, so it's hanging because it's waiting for that. Because when we create the subscription, it will create a logical replication slot on the standby, which is waiting for this whole record to arrive from the primary. So now I have my subscription. I can insert some data on the primary. Hopefully it's there in the standby, yes. Yeah, here I am just showing that there is a logical replication slot that has been created when I created the subscription. And on the subscriber side, we can see that it has been applied. The logical decoding has been done and the data is there. Let's clean this stuff and let's create a cascading standby now. So on the left, the primary. On the right, this is the first standby, and this new window now is a cascading standby. So I have a primary, a standby, and a cascading standby. Okay, and so yeah, it's in recovery. Yeah, okay, so on the primary, I create a table, I create a publication, and I link both. On the standby, I can see that I am in recovery, that I have my publication, and the table is empty. And on the cascading standby, so the standby of the standby, I have also the publication, and I have also the table that is empty. Now I will create a subscription, as we did previously, but this time from the cascading standby. So I create the table. I want to create the subscription, but from the cascading standby. So I will take isPort here. So let me copy it. I copy the port. Oops. It's hanging because it's waiting for this URL record to apply again, to arrive, I mean. So the subscription has been created on the cascading standby. So if I insert some data on the primary, I can see it on the standby. I can see it on the cascading standby, and I can see it on the subscriber. Now I will promote the initial standby. I mean the first standby, not the initial. So I promote it. I insert some data in it. We can see that. We can see it in the standby now, which was the cascading standby before. And then also on the subscriber. Now I can also promote the cascading standby, insert some data in it, and we can see that yeah, the subscriber has been able to decode as well. So we have seen that we can also play with cascading standby, promote one of them or both, and it still continue to do the logical decoding. So I will stop there. I mean, I will not do cascading for cascading for cascading. I think we got it. So now, let's do another stuff. I think now it's time to show the conflicts. Okay, so on the left, I still have my primary. On the right, the standby. And now I say a standby feedback to off. And we see what happens. So I start the standby. So it's in recovery. I have a standby feedback set to off and a primary slot name. I want to create the logical replication slot. It's waiting for this again. I create a table on the primary. I insert some data in it. And I decode the change from the standby. It works. Because no conflict now, I mean, everything is fine. Now, let's do the example that you have seen in the slide. So I create a table. So it inserts some data in PG class. I drop the table, so it deletes this entry in PG class. And now I am just showing that even if now you have the slot the Xmin and the catalog Xmin from the standby are not known, which means that if I launch a vacuum now on PG class, we can see that all rows have been removed because zero death row cannot be removed. So there is no record of this relation anymore in PG class. And now if I want to decode on the standby, I have a conflict, because this is exactly what we have seen in the slides. So there is a new field conflicting in PG replication slot, and we can see that it is true, means the slot is conflicting. So it is not usable anymore, and the only thing that you can do is to drop it or to keep it. So here I drop it, I recreate one, and I will set hot standby feedback to on, start the standby, and let's see the differences now. So hot standby is set to on, I have my primary slot name. So exact same thing, I create the table, so insert some data in PG class, I drop the table, and now you see that there is some information here, so the catalog Xmin is known. So this is the information coming from the standby. Which means now if I run a vacuum, you see, everything has not been removed. So those four dead rows are still there thanks to this guy here. Which means that now, if I logical decode from the standby, that's perfectly fine. You see, it started from there, and here it has been able to decode those changes. So with the primary slot name plus hot standby feedback to on, there is no conflict in such cases. Let's see another one. So here I change the wall level because I said initially in the slide that wall level has to be set to logical for the on the primary as well. Yeah, so now we can see that the slot is marked as conflicting as well because it detected that the wall level was not set correctly. So now if I set back to logical on the primary and I do logical decoding on the standby, so we have this error. Because even if we change it back to logical, we don't know what happened between the time it was not set to logical. And as the slot has been marked as conflicting initially, when it detected that wall level was not set to logical on the primary, so the slot is conflicting and you cannot use it anymore. And you have the explanation why here. And then again, the only thing that can be done is to drop the slot. And this will be the last one. I will show how we can synchronize slot in 16. So on the primary, I will create a logical replication slot. And I will create a logical replication slot on the standby that we will want to sync without using logical decoding. So on the primary, I create a table, I insert some data, and I am doing the logical decoding, and so I did some logical decoding on the primary. Now I want to synchronize these states on the standby, but without doing the logical decoding on the standby. What I can do is to copy this, confirm flush to LSN, and to advance the slot on the standby to this value. Oops. And now we can see that both are to the same value, which means that now if I switch back to the primary, I insert some data, and now suppose that the primary crash. As you have synchronized the slot, you can promote the standby or even logical decode from it. From the state it were on the primary because I synchronized it, which means that now if I decode on the standby, I will see only the new insert that has been done there and not what has been done previously. So we can resume the slot usage from this state. So in 16 it has to be done that way. I mean, it's not perfect of course, but it's still doable. And in 17, we have committed the new feature that will do that automatically, so that you could fail over automatically from the primary to the standby and resume logical decoding from there. That was the missing piece. And I think I am just cleaning up and it's done. Yeah. So it's okay for the presentation. It's done. Thank you.
Are there any questions?
So you mentioned that you can do logical replication with different versions, between different versions, right?
Yeah.
So this can enable maybe some different way for upgrading a primary replica, for example.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Exactly. Yeah.
Okay. Is there any constraint or limitation that should be taken into account if you want
yeah,
to do that?
So the way logical decoding is done is the exact same as before the feature. The only stuff that has been added is dealing with conflict and all this kind of stuff. So it means that the constraint and are exactly the same as before. Yeah.
In your very first slides, you were saying that, or it sounded like logical replication was just plain better in all aspects. Is that really the case, or are
no.
there any downsides?
No, there is, again, there is pros and cons. There is some stuff that you cannot do with logical replication currently, like DDL replication, sequence replication, and this kind of stuff. Yeah.
Any other questions? Oh.
Tu me dis, Carole,
So thank you for this presentation and for all of this work. It's a huge work, so thank you. So if I understand, currently we can't use a logical replication to perform a failover. And the next step, it's in 17, hopefully, with replication slot synchronization, we can hope to perform a failover and to still be able to connect our logical replication slot on the promoted server.
Exactly. So in 17, hopefully, if the commit is not reverted, you will be able to synchronize primary logical replication slot to standby, means when there is a failover, you can simply resume from the standby or from the promoted standby from where it was on the primary. It will be done automatically. There is a new flag to set when you create a subscription or when you will create a logical replication slot. You will have to say failover equal on, and then there is an extra parameter on the standby to set, so that it pulls the metadata information directly from the primary. So this will be automatically with this new parameter. And in 16, you can still do it, but manually, as I show at the end. It's not perfect, but it's probably better than nothing.
I think we're all good. Thank you very much for a very, very interesting presentation.
Thank you.